Let our life accomplish that which you desire. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name, we pray. Now, there's a young man in the scripture that I believe you are probably familiar with. When God talks about changing the world, I want you to understand what he is not talking about and what he is talking about. The best way to look at how to change the world is to simply look at Jesus Christ. You know, when Jesus came, he had everything to occupy the highest political and political office of his time. He could easily have become king. And Julius Caesar would not have been able to defeat Christ if he was an earthly king. He could easily be the head of a military, and the Roman army would not be able to defeat him. He could have been the best philanthropist, distributing money and food everywhere. It's interesting that Jesus did not do that. That's what you and I will have loved to do. In fact, they wanted to make Jesus king, and the Bible says he ran to the mountain. I thought he came to change the world. Why will he reject an opportunity to affect the world? As we will see it, that Jesus will refuse being the king. What was his strategy? So that you see, we don't labor in vain. His strategy was to deal with the fundamental problem of man, which is sin. The problem of man is not poverty, it's not bad governance. Jesus could have addressed all of those ones. With one strip of the finger, everybody will have food in their house. But that was not the problem of man. He fed people to show to them that if food was your problem, I can feed you more than you can ever eat. So he didn't interfere with the political class to seek political power. Now, I'm not by that saying that a Christian cannot occupy political office. In fact, we pray for more of that. However, we are not going to transform this world through political means primarily. The transformation only comes when the major issue, which is sin, is addressed in the man. No man is changed until the issue of sin is dealt with in the life of that man. You can become chief executive. You can become almost anything. I had the story this week, you know, of a professor. Before he got married, he had a child. Got married, had some children. Now, as I'm speaking, he has gone outside again to have a child. You see, he's a professor, but he's a fool. I'm not abusing him, I'm describing him. Well, there is a difference. You see, Jesus doesn't abuse people, but you see, he calls several people, he said, that fool. It's not an abuse. If you are a fool, you are a fool. If you are a thief, and I say you are a thief, it's not abuse, you are a thief. I'm not judging you. Say, don't judge. Who is judging you? You are a thief. We call you a thief. You say, we are judging you. I'm shameful. So if you say I'm shameful, you are not judging me. That's who I am. So you see, he could become popular. He could even become a vice chancellor. But he's still a fool. Because the fundamental change has not taken place. So for this morning, will we just look at how God affect the world through men. And we will just study one young man that God, through him, did a great change and impact in the world. So if you have your Bible, let's look at Genesis. Genesis chapter 37. And we'll be looking at Joseph, the man that changed the world. Joseph, the man that changed the world. Genesis chapter 37. We will just highlight a few things from his life, and then we will commit ourselves to prayer. The first thing you want to notice in verse 2 is this. He says, "These are the generations of Jacob." Now, notice the word "these" is plural. Notice the word "generations" is plural. If we had had time to look at the scripture before this chapter, when God said, "These are the generation of Adam, of Abraham, of Isaac," he began to show their children. But here we see that the scripture says, "These are the generations of Jacob." What's the next thing? He was not the firstborn. He was not the secondborn. Not 4, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, not even 9, not 10. How come the generations of Jacob is Joseph? Now that is to tell us that we must focus on this brother and check something about his life. That the only person God could connect to Jacob was Joseph, even though he had several brothers. What is it that makes Joseph to become the generations of Jacob? Now, the scripture says, being 17 years old, was a teenager. Being 17 years old. So that's where we are starting his story from. Was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was the sons of Bilhah, and with the sons of Zilpa, his father's wife. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil reports. God opened to us the life of a young man at the age of 17. Please, I'm sure there are some of you here that are older than 17. But I want to plead with you. Please pay attention. God doesn't focus on a life when the life is old and mature. God focuses on a life very early. Am I saying God cannot save a 90-year-old man? He can. But God himself will not invest his resources on a 90-year-old man. God himself will not do it. Except if God is going to extend his life like Moses, that was ready for God at the age of 80, but God gave him 40 years more. So he served God for the next 40 years until he was 120. But you see, God always comes for a life very early. The other side of it is that the devil also comes for a life very early. You see, so by the time the devil grabs a young man and he becomes a famous musician, you wouldn't know what that man would have become if he had given to God. All you are going to see about that man is that this is a secular artist. He himself will not be able to see what he will have become if he had yielded to God. Anyone that God will use to affect their generation, he comes for them very early. Usually it is men that actually delays God. You know that even for Jesus, God revealed his life to us at the age of 12. At the age of 12, and you know that's a lesson for parents, he was already able to have an understanding of God. And that tells us that any 12-year-old child can be like that. But you know what we will do? We will say that they are still young. They are still young. They are not ready for the meat of the word of God. Let's just teach them some things. By the time you are teaching adults the meat of the word of God, there is little they can do with it. They will just keep hearing it, developing facts by you, and they are just going to be on the same spot. Not too much. Because they have made several critical decisions of their life. God wants to come very early in your life before you make critical decisions. One of it is marriage. Because see, when you get it wrong at that point, it becomes not impossible but difficult to correct. And there is no way you will suffer some consequences. So if God will use anybody, he comes very early. And you know, at the age of 16, a brother called me. I was in secondary school, probably SS1. He called me and he told me, he said, he's been fasting for 3 days. Maybe on the third day or so, I can't remember exactly. He said, God opened his eyes and revealed me to him. And he saw what I was going to become. At the age of 16, he told me that. I really didn't understand what he was saying. Did you know that part of what he said he saw and told me is what you are saying before you now? What I'm doing today, somebody saw it in 1996 and told me. And so I realized that you must not joke or play with your youthful years. But you know what the devil does? He makes you to play and joke with that life. That is when you chat your life away on social media. That is the time you watch movies and you don't have time for the scriptures. That is the time you begin to do boyfriend and girlfriend. So he fills you with all kinds of activities that will not lead you into the program of God for your life. Whereas, if there's any time for you to be most serious with God, it's now. You are not too young. The devil can.
Do you remember in the book of Acts, say Acts chapter 16, the young girl that was already possessed? Maybe she was around 7 or 8 years old. Yet the devil didn't consider her to be too small to be possessed. And the Bible says he followed Paul, telling them, these are the people that come to show the way of the Lord. Accurate information, but from the devil. If Paul was not discerning and rebuked that spirit, if they had thought, you see what he's saying is correct. You know, people are deceived today in the church. Say, that man of God, he can see things. If Paul had not rebuked him, you know what would have happened? When they will have gone, people will believe that lady. Because they believed in Paul. And Paul didn't rebuke her. So they will have believed that young girl. And so she will now have confidence to prophesy evil and they will follow it. She will scatter the church, she will destroy the people. But my point is that the devil didn't consider her too young to use her. In fact, even in football, do you know that when you are 30 years old, you are really no more of value in football? They say it's old. Go and check football. By the time you are 29, they say, this person is at the twilight of his football career at 29. So the world system also appreciates that you need to come in very early. Most American presidents, except for the last two, the current one, the last one, most of them came to power at the age of 40-something, 46, 43, 46, 43. At the age of 17. Now, but what happened to him? The Bible says he brought unto his father their reports, their evil reports. The first thing we are noticing about this man who changed his own world is that he will not join other people to sin. He doesn't belong. And you know, it's difficult not to belong. Many, you can't serve God, you can't follow God if you cannot be alone. How will you have 11 brothers and they are doing something and only you will now say, I'm sorry, I cannot do that. And then you will report it to their father that this is what they are doing. They will kill meat, they will do barbecue. They will sell your meat, they will sell your cattle, they will give the money. Joseph will say, no, I'm sorry, I cannot do that. He started being lonely right from any age. Whereas, God is calling you to that lonely life. You have a problem with it because you want to fit among other people. You want to belong. You want to do what they are doing. You want to dress the way they dress. You want to use the kind of phone they are having. You want to engage in their ungodly conversation. You can't change anything. Anyone that will be useful in changing the world must be ready to stand alone. In Proverbs, it says, my son, if sinner entice thee, consent thou not. Do join them. So Joseph, at that very early age, was ready to stand alone. He was ready to be mocked. He was ready to be called SU at that tender age. Most people don't like that experience. We want to fit in. Now, if you go to verse 4, it says, and when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him.
They hated him not because he offended them, but because somebody else loved him. How many of us are ready for that kind of persecution? You know, at times you feel that, but I didn't do anything to them. I don't know why they hate me. When it comes to hatred, people don't need reason to hate. Hatred is in people's hearts. It's not in your action. People will hate you not because you did anything, but because they have hatred. Otherwise, why is somebody, because someone loves this person, you now hate the person? Why didn't you hate the person that loved him? And why didn't you do what this person is doing to make this other person love him? He was being isolated. He was being hated. How do you cope with that in the home? Every day of his life, the Bible says, they never speak peaceably unto him. Joseph, why did you do this? You this stupid boy. He did no wrong, and yet they hated him. Why do you think anybody will hate Jesus? The Bible says he went about doing good, yet they hated him. What was the offense of Abel? He didn't do anything to Cain, yet he hated him and killed him. So please understand that envy, hatred, has nothing to do with you. No matter what you do, people that will hate you, will hate you. People that will envy you, they will envy. It's not, so don't waste your time with that. You see, I see so many jobless people on social media. All my haters. It shows that you also you have problems. Who are your haters? All the time, you don't have any reasonable posts. It's just all the haters. All the people who are saying we will not shine, they will see us in glory. And you think we're a Christian. Something is wrong with you. Why is it that is your own issue? Why are you bothered about that? Haters will not finish. And Jesus has taught us how to deal with them. He said, do good to them that hate you. So why waste your time talking about haters, 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 as if you want to intimidate them to stop? They won't stop. In fact, my prayer is that they will hate you for the right reason. You see, that's a great prayer. Don't let them hate you because you are sinning. Let them hate you because you are righteous. Let them hate you because you refuse to join them. Let them hate you because you refuse to compromise. That's a good prayer. You know, we love wrong prayer. Somebody said, receive your spouse. And people said, amen. And that's how somebody will go and receive Ojuju. I said, is that how they marry? You can't sit people down like this and teach them from the word of God, the counsel of God concerning marriage. You are telling them to receive their spouse. The other time, somebody said, if you want to get married this year, dance to the altar. And people dance to the altar. You know, people love those kind of senseless things. I said, you are dancing. I said, number one, there is no altar. There is pulpit. This is not an altar. It's a pulpit. It's just a pulpit. You know what an altar is? There is no altar today. You know, but because we call some of these things by some scriptural names, it gives people problems. So you see, people will say, I don't want to pray at the altar. Jesus said, if you abide in me and my word abide in you, you will ask anything you want and I will do it. God doesn't answer prayer because you run to this place. God answers prayer because you meet his covenant requirements. Prayer is by covenant, not by sentiments. God doesn't do all of those. You see, you can run on the ground, Father, see me.
It doesn't change anything. He has told you what to do for him to answer your prayers. Just go and do it. God is not sentimental. So you see, people said, you know, I went to the altar this morning. I said, which altar? Are you Abraham? Are you also building altar? We don't have any altar because we are now in Christ. This is pulpit. Pulpit. Don't honor this place. You see, people will say, they are even doing it on church premises. I said, you see, that's the problem. You have hallowed church premises. What you should hallow is your body. The Bible says your body is the temple of God. So even if your body is in an hotel, it should not be used to sin. It's not a matter of because we are in church. People will say, you are still doing this in the church. No, we are the church. It's not this church building. If you hallow your own body, anywhere your own body is becomes hallowed. But because we often say, preachers, you say, altar, according to the God of this altar. They can say all of those things, but you see, God is not sentimental. He doesn't, you can cry, you can say, oh Lord, but look at me. He said, if you abide in me, and my word abide in you, you will ask anything, I will do it. So stop running to people here and there. Just do what he says you should do, and you will have answers to your prayer. So Joseph was hated for being right. The next thing we are going to see about him is in verse 5. The Bible says, and Joseph dreamed a dream and told it to his brethren. And they did what? They hated him. You see, hatred has degrees. Hatred can grow. But have you heard this word? Dream big. Dream big. You know the way the Bible puts it, said Joseph dreamed a dream. Joseph dreamed a dream. Let me explain this to you. Joseph didn't sit down and say, I want to become great. God was the one who birthed his plan in his heart. Don't go and be dreaming big. Ask God to put his plan in your heart. You know, because when they say dream big, as if all I have to do is just to set myself to achieve big, big, big things. That's not Christianity. Christianity is God achieving his own purpose through you, not my own purpose. You are actually not living for God if you are pursuing your own purpose. Real Christianity, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 15 says, in that he died for all, that they who live should no longer live for themselves. That's a message to believers, not to pastors. But live for him who died and rose again. So our own concept of dreams is not you sitting somewhere to dream. You know, and you know, people will say Joseph the dreamer. Joseph was not a dreamer. All his life, he was recorded to have dreamt only one dream twice. How can you call somebody who had only one dream twice be a dreamer? Do you have any dreams you have had all your life? My own is even worse. If I'm in a bus and I'm sleeping, I'm dreaming. It's dream. So, if I dream about you and come and tell you, please, just ignore it. My dream is as useless as anything. So, I have to learn how to depend on the word of God, not dreams. Dreams will mislead you. You see, God doesn't give dreams. You know, people will call me and say, sir, I have this dream. What's the interpretation? You see, they still have babalawo mentality. When you go and consult somebody who tells you something, I say, number one, do you think that God is useless, is jobless, that every day he's just giving you dreams that you don't even know where the head is or where the pain is? When you look
at people who had dreams in the Bible, it's usually not more than once, twice at most. And it is very purposeful and deliberate. That's the dream that counts. The other one is just a product of our active mind. So in a lifetime, someone may not see a dream from God more than once. Now, if it pleases God, he can give you 10. Can give you 100. I'm not God, so I'm not limiting him. But judging by the scripture, dreams that come from God is not usually a frequent thing. Even Paul, he had a dream only once that was recorded. And even that dream, they took time to investigate before they could say God is calling them to Macedonia. So, the dream that will change this world is a dream that is given to you by God. If what you are pursuing is your own dream, you can't change anything. You will make the world worse.
So you had a dream, and because of that, they eventually sold him into slavery. But before they sold him, let me show you something that happened to him in verse 12. In verse 12, the scripture says, and his verse 13, and Israel said unto Joseph, do not thy brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, and I will send thee unto them. And he said to him, here I am.
Did you know that the beginning of the fulfillment of the plan of God for Joseph was on his obedience to run an errand for his father? This journey, he didn't return from it. It was his father who called him and said, let me send you. You know, you may trivialize your parents. You think that there is no Christ in washing plates. You think that there is no purpose in cleaning their house. You think that there is nothing to come out of you going to clean the house. For Joseph, it was obedience to run an errand for his father that marked the beginning of his journey to fulfillment. Did you remember it was the same thing with David? David was anointed to be king. And the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came mightily on him. But after that, nothing. Nothing. He just went back to the bush. He carried Holy Ghost back to the bush. Nothing. Until one day, his father also said, come, go and check your brethren who are fighting with Saul. Go and check them for me. That was the beginning of his journey to the throne. Because he obeyed his father, he saw Goliath for the first time. He didn't know what was going on. It's not like today that you have Facebook, that somebody would have been showing Goliath live. They would have been sending videos of Goliath on WhatsApp. Hey, this is the man who... There was no communication. He didn't know. But because his father sent him and he obeyed, he got there. And then he saw Goliath and he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistines that defiled the army of the living God? My point is this. Don't trivialize things that look little and ordinary to you. It is in those things that you will find God. Being obedient. Jesus said, if you are faithful in little, you will be faithful with much. Stop waiting until one big future when you will now become obedient. If you are still the type that when your parents say, go and do this, you are still like this.
you are very far from the purpose of God. Work will not kill you. You see, what they are asking you to do may not make sense to you. How can Joseph alone be going inside the bush looking for people? There was no GPS. It's not as if he was going to make call. Hello, brother, where are you people? I'm coming. Where is the path? Where should I take? No landmark. He was going to, and you will discover, I just don't want to read all of that. But he was looking for them. Somebody said, no, they had left, they have gone to another place. He was looking for them. Who wants to run that kind of errand? The little assignment that they give you in church could be what will take you into the plan of God for your life. Don't trivialize it. Don't feel that it is too small. Please just go and help us coordinate these children. When I joined the children's Sunday school in my church some years ago, they posted me to nursery class. So I went to the director. I said, please, I want to go to SS class. Because nursery class is there, they have only toddlers and all this mommy. So I'm just the only male among them. So I didn't like it. The man would say, no, don't worry, they want a female, a male figure among them and so on. Eventually I saw that it was God. So I stopped seeking for them to remove me. And I served them faithfully. Among kids. At that time I felt that I could teach teenagers better than to be teaching a two-year-old. What would I teach a two-year-old? But it was plan of God for my life. So don't trivialize what you think are little assignments. It is those little assignments that is counting before God. It's not a big assignment. Those little assignments will qualify you for a big assignment. If you are the choir coordinator, please do it with all your heart. Do it as your own. Do it as unto God. So he obeyed his father. And then they sold him into slavery. Can we turn to chapter 39? I'm sure you know the part how he got to Egypt. Just for being righteous. Did you know that all that Joseph had been suffering was just for being right? At times you think you are suffering because you have done something wrong. There is a suffering that comes because you are actually doing something right. So his own suffering got to the point where he was sold into slavery for just being righteous. Imagine, how would you feel with God? You know, many of us will easily get offended at God. And Jesus said, blessed is he who is not offended at me. But when something happened, you are like, why God? How do you think Joseph will feel? That for being righteous, he became a slave. Anyway, so in chapter 39, he became a slave. Let's look at verse 2. The Bible says, and the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. The man that can bring about change in our world is a man that carries the presence of God. Actually, what brings that change is the presence of God in your life. But you see, the man that will also carry the presence of God is also the man that will not grieve the Holy Spirit. Is a man that will not grieve that presence. Secondly, how could God describe a boy whose teenage life has been in frustration
to the point of becoming a slave to say he was a prosperous man. How can he be a prosperous man? If you are going to have impact in this world, you must learn to see things from the eyes of God, not from the eyes of men. Your life is not defined by your circumstance, but by Christ in you. The day you begin to feel that you are a failure because you don't have a car, you don't have admission, you are not married, you don't have a house, you have already, when you see things that way, you have already shifted from the plan of God. Stop judging your life by worldly attainment or material acquisition. Here was a man that by every standard is a man you should pity. He's a man you should describe as miserable. But the Bible says he was a prosperous man and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Why was he a prosperous man? You see, prosperity is the presence of God in a life. It's not the presence of cash. Prosperity is Christ in you, not money in your hand. The day you understand that, you will be delivered from competition. You will be delivered from judging your own life wrongly. You know, people judge their own life wrongly. When you say to yourself, I have nothing. What does Joseph have here? Do you think Joseph came to Egypt with a briefcase or traveling bag? Nothing. Probably naked. Or something on his body. That's all. His toothbrush was at home. His ATM card was at home. Nothing. And then God said he was prosperous. How? You know, many preachers of our time, they don't like this type of scriptures. They wish they could remove it from the Bible. Because their own heart is so set on money that the only prosperity they know is naira and kobo. Prosperity that is subject to a man. I just read this morning that Britain is changing pounds, 20 pounds, 50 pounds from paper to folio something. They are using another material to produce it. And so by 31st of December this year, if you have 20 pounds, 50 pounds, that is on paper, you must go and deposit it. Otherwise, it becomes useless. It's human being defining that. Nigeria, without sat down, we printed the paper and wrote 1,000 naira on it. And it's 1,000. Did you know if we are printing 10,000 naira on it, it will be 10,000. You go to the forest, you bought a tree that God created. You process it into paper. And then you write figure on it. And then somebody is telling you that's why Jesus died. It's an insult to the name of Jesus to say that's why he died. So they say he became poor so that we can become rich. I said, so, tell me how Jesus depleted his own dollars so that I can have it. Maybe he became poor. That means he had money. That's the interpretation. He had money. So he gave the money so that I can be rich. So tell me where Jesus acquired dollars that he now gave it so that I can be rich. It's a dangerous thing when with a heart that loves money can never preach the Bible correctly. Every verse he reads, he will relate it to money. Every verse. Any ordinary only communion is a prosperity message. Everything, baptism is a prosperity message. In fact, they motivate you to live holy with money. If you want the Lord to bless you, you must abstain from every sin. The Bible says his eyes is too holy to behold iniquity.
If you want to walk in prosperity, you must abstain. So you see,
you will think that's a good message. It's a demonic message. That means that they have raised money to become God. That is enough motivation to make you live right. Many of the commitment you see to people to church activity is because they have told them that part of the key to financial prosperity is that you must be working in the house of God.
So they are ready to wake up 6 a.m. to be rushing for workers' meeting. Not because of Jesus, because of mammon. That is not a service that is acceptable to God. We must never serve God for money. But you see, God is too faithful not to provide for his own. He said, your heavenly Father knows that you have these needs. Let me delete and tell you this, so that some people, their heart will get at peace. In my 300 years of university, I read the story of Watchman Nee. How he stopped asking his parents for money and decided to trust God. I was so challenged by that story. I said I was also going to do it. So I was to pay for my school fee in my final year of 100 level. I refused to tell anybody. I didn't discuss that I need a dime with anybody. And it also happened that nobody remembered that my school fees should be paid. I said, God, if Watchman Nee can trust you, I also want to trust you. You said you are my heavenly Father. You see, that's why it's good to know God early. There are some things you can't do as an adult. That time my faith was a little bit reckless. So I said, Lord, I was going to trust you. So I started. And then after a while, they issued money that school fees will soon be closed. Then it closed and they said, late fees. I don't even have any fees. Now I'm purely late fees. And I'm going to lose a whole year in the university. How do I explain to anybody in the family that I'm going to lose, I'm losing a year in the university because I just decided to be stupid? Those thoughts came to my heart. At times I'll be afraid. But then again, I'll be encouraged that this God, if I can't trust God now, when will I ever be able to trust God? So then they said, school fees is closed. I couldn't eat. I said, well, God, if this is the consequence, maybe I didn't get you correctly. Maybe I made some mistake, but at least I tried. And then one sister came in the evening to visit. She was coming from Enugu. She said she went to Delta to see my brother, who was also serving in Delta State. My brother gave her a bag to give to me, a nylon bag. So she delivered it. When I checked it, there was a Dixman there and an envelope. I opened it, there was money there. I counted it. It will pay my school fees and I still have some change left. But there's a problem. School fees is closed. So with fear and trembling, I went to the school bursary. This is the University of Ilorin. We were paying to bursary then, not online. And I stretched my school fees to them with fear. They took it, took the normal fee, issued me receipt, I went away. Hey! I said, the world will hear this story. Yeah. And then so, God, I can trust you. You see, you need experience like that. So if I'm saying that they should not make money about God, it's because I know that God will provide for us. You know the interesting thing? When my brother came and I told him, he was silent for a long time. I said, what happened? He said he was serving in a local government, they call only local government. He wanted to travel to Abuja, so he needed to leave that local government to
the state capital, where he would then vehicle to Abuja. When he got to the state capital, he remembered that he did not switch off a fan in his school and decided to go back. Now, this sister had come to that local government and they told her, my brother had gone to Abuja. Rather than come back and be going, she just became confused. She just stood there, she didn't know what to do. In that confusion, my brother returned back from the state capital Abuja and said, how are you? Oh, I'm going to Abuja. Please give this to Shebu. So that was why my brother was shocked. That's what God sent him back to go and give that money just for him. You know, it's because we have not taken God at his word. And you cannot experience God until you take him at his word. It is risky trusting God. That's why most people don't want to do it. We love what is sure, what we can see, what we can relate with. You know, that thing delivered me completely from trusting men. And since that time, by God's grace, I've been learning to trust God. In fact, when I wanted to get married, I sat my wife down and I told her, I am not the breadwinner, and I'm not going to be the breadwinner of this marriage. So hear it before you enter into it. I'm learning, me myself, I'm trusting God. The Bible says, cause is he who put his trust in another. If you put your trust in me as a wife, you are under a curse. It's not biblical. I'm not saying I'll be irresponsible, but I'm saying we will both be looking up to God. Are you okay with it? He said, yes, I have better. You see, so I was able to take, because how can I, that I'm trusting God, be assuring you that I will take care of you? How? When I don't have what it takes to take care of you, me also, I have to receive it from somebody else. So let's the two of us be trusting that God that he will take care of us. It's a wonderful lesson for me to learn. So the Lord said that he was prosperous and he was in the house of his master. And his master saw that the Lord was with him. The presence of God in a life is tangible. If people can't see it, is either that it's not there or it's being shielded. How can an ungodly man, Potiphar, notice what was it about Joseph that will make them to see that the Lord was him? When he didn't have money, today we think God is with you. You know, when you see it, you know, somebody says something, said he saw a wealthy friend. You now say, God has answered his own prayer. I say, so because he has a good job now, he has a car, he has his own house, his money, God has answered his prayer. So your own prayer, and it's still pending because you don't have this thing. See how blind you have become. So all the unbelievers too, who have cars, who have houses, God has answered their prayer. You, his own children, he's not answering your prayer. How can somebody say the Lord was with Joseph when he had nothing to show for it? It is because the presence of God is not expressed in materialism. It is expressed in our character. That's why the scripture says, those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ. We may not all have mansions, but we can all be Christ-like. We may not all travel abroad, but we can all become like Jesus. What people really need to see is Christ in you. See, it's not even preaching. Not because I preach, I have one fear. I don't want people to judge my Christian life by my preaching. I want people to judge my Christian life by my behavior. I want you to see me outside of this preaching and still be able to say, this brother is a Christian. Because it is easy for you to see me now and say, oh, he's a Christian. But I want us to enter box together that I didn't know you. And they will provoke me inside that box. And then you will see the way I handle it, and then you will say, this is a child of God. It's not preaching. He said, by their fruit you shall know them, not by their works. Let's speed up a little. There are so many things in this brother's life. All right. Verse 7. I'm showing you the journey of a man that God used to change the world. So that as God is taking you through, you can learn one or two things from his own life that will help you. In verse 7, the Bible says, and it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph and said, lie with me. The first thing that happened was that she cast her eyes on Joseph. Not on anybody, but Joseph. You know why? The scripture says, an adulterous woman will seek the precious life. What you think is a simple opportunity for you is a bait to destroy the purpose of God in your life. How come this woman didn't find Egyptian men attractive anymore? It's Jews. You know how these Egyptians are so beautiful and handsome. Compared to the Jews, at least up to today, you can still see it. Up to today. But it was Joseph that this woman found attractive. If your life has meaning with God, sin will find you attractive. You can't escape it. It's on our journey. She cast her eyes and said, lie with me. That's opportunity for sinful pleasures. Along your journey is sinful pleasure. Sin will come to you on a platter of goods, well dressed, and they will tell you it's free of charge. Because they know that if they tell you the price, you won't do it. The wages of sin is death. What do we have in verse 8? What did you see in verse 8? What did Joseph do? That's verse 8. He refused. The problem is not temptation. The problem is not the thought that comes to your hearts. The problem is what you do with it. You can accept it, you can reject it. The problem is not the offer. There will be people who will want to have sexual chats with you. On WhatsApp, on Facebook, on Telegram. That person is not your problem. That problem is your response. When you refuse. How do you refuse? Nobody can force you to sin. You know why? Sin, for it to be reckoned as sin, has to be willing. So the devil could only convince Adam and Eve. He could not force them. So they did what they did of their own will. Don't say, well, is this person? I don't know. He said, every time I'm with this person, I'm just falling into sin. He's not that person. They know that is this lady. She has spirit of seduction. Where did you read that in the Bible? When the Bible talks about spirit of seduction, you know what he talked about? He talked about demonic spirit. He said, giving heed to seducing spirit, they have departed from the faith. Seducing spirit are not sexual spirits. Seducing spirits are heretic spirit that teaches you, that manipulate the scripture as to shift you from the truth. Doctrines of demons that have been preached on our pulpit. I just gave you an example not a while ago. That if you want to prosper, live a holy life. It sounds good, but it's a demonic doctrine. We don't live a holy life because we want to prosper, but because Jesus died on the cross for our sinful life. He said, therefore, reckon yourself to be dead indeed unto sin. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer than? Mammon must not be our motivation. So, Joseph said no. Brethren, there are things you must refuse if you want God to use you to change this world. Many people have failed because they refuse to refuse. Nobody is forcing you to do anything. Anything you are doing it on your own. But I must also stress, look at what Joseph said. But he refused and said unto his master's wife, behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house. And he had committed all that he had to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I. Neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? You must have a proper evaluation of sin if you are going to amount to anything with God. Who defined it as great? He didn't say, how can I do this wickedness? Look at his own evaluation of sin. He said, great wickedness. That's why some people, what does they call great wickedness? Some people will call it affairs. We are just having affairs. So it doesn't sound safe. Why is it just like side chicks? Side chick. It doesn't sound too serious. You know, we have names for simple things. Lust, we call it crush. Because when you say lust, you will definitely know what the Bible says about it. So they call it crush. Fornication, they call it affair. They're just having affair. Joseph said, great wickedness. They do know that anybody you are having sex with that is not your wife is somebody else's wife. Whether the person is married or not, did you know that? You are having sex with somebody else's husband. Either the person is married or the person is single. You know, a young lady told me, oh God. She was sleeping with the choir master in their church. And she said, sir, this man is so caring, so loving, he is the dream of any woman. You see how foolish sin can be. Which woman wants her own husband to be sleeping with other people? What the man is doing, if she was married to the man, she won't take it. Yes, she says, the man is the dream of any woman. You know, sin will make you stupid. Sin makes people extremely stupid. Sin will affect people's brain. they won't be able to raise him properly. How can you say he's every woman's dream?
She didn't know, and I said to her, and I said, you want to be married one day, and you want to have your husband, you want to have a good marriage, and you are destroying the marriage of another woman. The Bible says, whatever you sow, you will reap. Jesus said, do unto others what you will have them to do unto you.
Learn to treat women the way you will want your own daughter to be treated. He refused.
Now, if you look at verse 10, he said, and it came to pass as she spake to Joseph. When?
The day we die, we will be tempted. Make no mistake that maybe you will get to one level in your Christian walk, it will be over. Day by day. You, it's only once in 6 months and you are falling. Joseph, it was day by day. And remember, he was not born again. You are born again, you are spirit filled, tongue speaking. Day by day. Now, you see, I wish I had time to dramatize what was going on for you. Thank God my brother is here. Maybe one day they put it in drama. Do you think if a woman wants a man to sleep with him, do you think she's just going to say, come and sleep with me? When my dad wants to have her back, it is Joseph that will open her up. He's a slave boy. He cannot say no. When he wants to bring, he says, she set her leg. Joseph, come and bring this leg. She won't wear anything. But when you read it in the Bible, it does look like she just said, come and sleep with me.
Day by day. But what did he say? That he hearkened not unto her. Look at King James. He said, to lie by her or to be with her.
You know, devil not loves to negotiate. Okay. We will not have sex. Just come and lie down on my chest. Joe, I have no sex. Hey, but what's there in hockey? So we can't walk. You're only serious. Just walk. Happen. Okay, I agree. Let's just watch movies together. You mean you can't just sit by my side and watch movies? I won't touch you, I'm going to watch movies.
Okay.
Just send me a picture. Let me see what you are wearing. Just send me a picture. I want to see you.
But I'm far away now. I will not touch you from here.
So he said, he refused either to lie by her. You know, there's a difference between lie by her or to be with her. So the woman offered options. Option A, so sin become objective. Option A, option B, like he wants to be a billionaire.
Let me stop here.
What was the consequence of this refusal? Imprisonment. How will you feel if you refuse to sin and imprisonment was the next thing? Will you be bitter at God? This is the reason why many refuse to say no to sin. There is a consequence. If there is opportunity to steal money and you don't steal money, you will still have lack. Many people don't want to go through that shame of lack, so they will steal money. Joseph was not bitter with God. In fact, while in prison, he saw, I just don't want to read it again because of time. He saw two of his colleagues sad. He said, "Why are you sad? Please, who should be asked? Who should be sad in that prison? Who should be miserable? Who should be like, I don't understand this God? I've seen people because they feel they are rich, married, every they can't find a spouse. They are already getting tired of God. A friend of mine went to U.S. Embassy last week. They denied her visa. She had gone about 3 months earlier. And as we were speaking, she was saying she's confused. She doesn't understand this God. She's been praying for others. They were getting it. How come she didn't get it? She's just tired. I know she's offended at God. And you know, I couldn't tell her. When she told me, I was praying secretly, almost saying, Lord, let them deny her. Because if she got that visa, she already has a wrong doctrine, thinking that this is how God works. She's going to go with the mindset that this is how God works. And I said, Lord, if this visa will lead her to continue to believe wrongly, please deny her. That was my prayer. But if you feel, Lord, that it's okay, she will still be fine, let it be granted. Why did you be offended at God? Joseph was not. He was checking on people. Then when his brothers came and he revealed himself to them, you know what he answered? He said, don't feel bad. You sold me to save you. But actually, it was God who sent me ahead of you to save life. That's where I'm going. To get to that journey of saving life, changing the world, he had to go through all these processes. Did you note that what Joseph had to now do to change the world? Did you know it was in one day he came out of prison, he got married, they shaped him, they elevated him. One day, just one day. Interpreted him, solved problem of 7 years to go in one day. And because of him, lives were preserved. Joseph said, God has sent me ahead to save life. So God is looking for men and women he can use to save life, to preserve life. Because that is the way God changes this world. God changed the world by changing men, not by changing the world system. The world system is doomed for destruction. But as God, one after the other, changes men, he is able to affect this world positively. If we have genuine Christians in government, they will steal. The problem is that we only have Christian name carrying people in government. We really don't have Christians in government, just Christian name carrying people. Are you ready for God? Can God count on you? Let us pray.